keynote speaker is someone that is near and dear to this county and is someone that has incredible ties to where we all practice, and that is Congressman Mark DeSaulnier. He was sworn in as a member of the 114th Congress on January 16th of this year, filling the seat vacated by George Miller, retired. He represents the 11th Congressional District, which covers the majority of our county. Although a native son of Lowell, Massachusetts, Congressman DeSaulnier has considered Contra Costa a home for the past 40 plus years. After graduating from Holy Cross, Congressman DeSaulnier traveled cross-country, eventually settling in Concord, California. And throughout Mark DeSaulnier's political life, he has been a leader on issues of importance to working families and the middle class. And this prioritization owes in part to his early experiences as a young man in blue-collar industries, such as working as a probation officer, truck driver, and hotel services employee. During this period, Mark DeSaulnier was a member of the Teamsters International Union and a union representing hotel and restaurant employees, where he learned the importance of the organized labor to help balance the scales between employer and employee. Congressman DeSaulnier also understands issues related to small business owners, as he was one himself. Mark DeSaulnier owned and operated several successful Bay Area restaurants and bars in Concord, including TR's, which according to the old guys in my office, he was the best damn barkeep in Contra Costa. Mark DeSaulnier's public service began in 1988 when he was appointed to the Concord Planning Commission, and his rise in public life was meteoric from there. In 1991, he was on the Concord City Council. 1993, he was Concord City Mayor. 1994, he was appointed by the governor to a vacated seat on the Contra Costa County Board of Supervisors, and he was reelected to that position 3 times. At the county level, Congressman DeSaulnier championed several transportation projects that we all take for granted in our daily commutes, including the expansion of Highway 4 and the development of the fourth bore of the Calicot Tunnel. He introduced women's health programs to serve healthcare needs of all Contra Costa County women. He established a separate county budget that reviews and measures the effectiveness of programs that are targeted to help the women and children in Contra Costa. He also served for approximately 10 years on the Bay Area Air Resources Board, where he supported strong environmental regulations, including advocating for cleaner gasoline, lower emission vehicles, monitoring of dioxin, the banning of MTBE in gasoline, and the identification of secondhand smoke as a carcinogen. In 2006, Congressman DeSaulnier was elected to the California State Assembly, where he was the first freshman in history to chair the Assembly Transportation Committee. His over 40 bills in 2008 addressed school truancy, preschool access, childhood obesity, smoke-free workplaces, and creating opportunities for at-risk youth. In 2008, Congressman DeSaulnier was elected to the California State Senate, and where he continued to champion issues that impact the most vulnerable populations in our communities, such as introducing legislation to support the underserved and homeless youth. He also fought to end prescription drug abuse, protect homeowners from foreclosure, create strict guidelines to prevent the use of toxic pesticides in schools, and an issue that was near and dear to my heart. He was always a sympathetic and supportive ear during the court budget crisis over the last 7 years. During his service in the California legislature, Congressman DeSaulnier did earn a mark of F, but it's an F that I personally feel that he should be proud of, as it was issued by the National Rifle Association. After his election to to the U.S. Congress. He serves currently on the Committee on Education and the Workforce and the Committee on Oversight, Government, and Reform. So please, without further ado, a warm welcome to Congressman Mark DeSaulnier.
Oh, that was an extensive biography. I can skip most of my PowerPoint. But you have an exciting PowerPoint ahead of you. And I want to thank Nick and thank all of you for having me here. It is a rite of passage for those of us who are older. One of the many rites of passage. Now I have a new one. I get to speak to the Contra Costa Bar Association. My connection is through your current president. And I get to know him because his father and his partners used to hang around in the restaurant I owned in Congress. Both the bar section and the food section. I think mostly the food section. And I can't help but say my parents, my mom wanted me to be a priest and my father wanted to be a lawyer, so I thought being a saloon owner was a nice compromise. How about me being a member of Congress? And I do want to tell you how delightful it is to be home. Nick and I were just talking about people always ask about the schedule. And the learning process is pretty amazing. I'm going to talk a little bit about this during questions, perhaps. Having I don't know about the rise of my political career. My predecessor likes to describe it as a slow, plodding crawl towards power, as it took 25 years to get to Congress. Not that that was a goal. The Chamber of Commerce asked me to go to the Planning Commission 25 years ago, and I did it. And it was an opening. Ron Mullins, many of you know, decided not to run for re-election to the City Council. And the Chamber, which is always sort of funny because business people now, in those days I was a Republican, of course, you could be a liberal Republican years ago now. I'm not aware of any. I tell my staff sometimes in D.C., one of the staff people who had worked there for some time was really traumatized when we interviewed for the job, and she said, "I have to ask you a question, how could you have been a Republican?" So I tried to explain to her that there used to be, having grown up in the Northeast, there were Rockefeller, progressive on social issues, Republicans, more business-oriented, not necessarily conservative fiscally, but more business-oriented. And you could see that she just couldn't process this, which is a real problem, and we can talk about the historical aspects of Lyndon Johnson and all the wonderful work he did around civil rights that we still argue with in Congress, and then Richard Nixon taking advantage of that to sort of make the Republican Party much more conservative, in my view. There are people who find that the Democratic Party got more liberal. I would argue that the Republican Party definitely got more conservative when they absorbed the South. So with that, we'll go through the PowerPoint as quickly as possible. And it's always a little bit of an adventure. We do a lot of these. I've done 9 town halls. I like to do community outreach. I think we're all a reflection of our background and having been in a retail business. I actually like working with my constituents. So we do over district office hours, which I'll briefly talk about. But we do a lot in outreach with the community. I always say that for people who won't come to my town halls and want to argue with me, I probably should, this is one of our secrets. I bore them to death so that their anger subsides by the time we get to questions. So I'll try that out. Just so you know, this is the Congressional District. This is probably all of you know, there's a big effort right now nationally. Ellen Tusher is part of this to do more of what we did in California to create independent redistricting commissions. Prior to that, the legislature made it up. And you all have all heard about gerrymandering, named after Eldridge Gerry, a member of the Constitutional Convention from Massachusetts, who got to draw his own lines at one point. So the redistricting commission, I think, did a remarkably good job. We Democrats think so because we ended up getting more positions in the largest delegation in the Congress, which is also interesting to be part of. There's this lovely relationship with our delegation, just as with California in general, with the rest of the country, where they admire a lot of the things we do here, even if they question some of it. They certainly like our weather and our current economy, until they find out what the price of housing is here, or kind of sit traffic. But as a general rule, I think California, with a big delegation, was well served with an independent redistricting commission. there's a big strategy now, both in the Democratic Congressional Committee and the Republican Congressional Committee. The Republicans were very good in the last redistricting, making sure they got control over 30 state houses who had redistricting authority. So when you look at the overall turnout nationally, the Democratic turnout is much higher nationally, but we don't have control of the House of Representatives or the Senate, and the outlook until the next redistricting is dim because of gerrymandering. There have been a number of court cases. There's one right now in Florida that looks like it will flip, and they're going to have to go out and redo their districts because they gerrymandered them so badly. There's a condition in the Florida Constitution that says you can't do that. And there are a number of other states that go through that. So that shouldn't get stuck on the first PowerPoint page. We'll be there all day. But this is a wonderful district. It's got a lot of wealthy areas, a lot of areas of challenge and poverty, and it's got a lot of very middle-income areas. But it's very highly educated. I don't have to go through this, but Nick went through this already. All my greatness. You can spend more time on that if you'd like. This is the kind of stuff we do every day. We spend a lot of time, for instance, in the last 72 hours on responding to Paris and national security and the vote we took yesterday on the Syrian refugee issue, which was interesting, and I'd love to talk more about that. I'm still processing it. But this is the day-to-day nuts and bolts of being a representative in any office you're in. It's really just responding to constituent needs. If you want to introduce our district director, Chanel Scales, who's right here, who worked for George Miller before me, and now runs both our Walnut Creek office and our Richmond office. So briefly, the national economic outlook is still good. Underlying this, of course, is a lot of cynicism around wages and the whole issue of how this is an investment recovery, and that the imbalance that Thomas Piketty and others write about in terms of capital in the economy and wages. And my own strong belief that we've got to get wages up, whether it's minimum wages or others, because middle-income people are suffering, and poverty, particularly in California, is a real problem. So having said that, this is sort of, the economy is still remarkably good, particularly in terms of the rest of the world, in Europe, Japan, and now even the Chinese, and so the economy slows down. I'm reading Bob Rice's most recent book, and I told Nick I better stop reading books on the current situation in the world, because I'm just to the point where Secretary has pointed out all the challenges we have in this country, and it's just starting to where we get remedies. But a lot of what he writes about is this issue about wages and getting people to get to have more wages, because from a purely economic standpoint, when you have an economy that derives 70% of its revenue from consumer goods, if you don't have a vibrant middle class, you really can't grow more than 2 or 3% a year if you're lucky. So California continues to do remarkably well. As you can see, we've got a GDP of $2.3 trillion. And when you look at those countries around us, ahead of us and behind us, they're much bigger than us. So still, we forget because we're here, but with just about 39 million Californians now to have an economy, a GDP of $2.3 trillion is really pretty remarkable. This is our employment rate in California. In the East Bay, it struggled a little behind our West, South Bay counties, but we are doing better all the time. Again, there are a lot of statistics to show that although unemployment is down, we've got a lot of people who are either working poor or middle class who are living paycheck to paycheck. In Reich's book, he says that 66% of Americans are now living paycheck to paycheck, which is obviously a problem. And this is another, just in terms of the California economic outlook and labor force, is that more people are working. The Bay Area, I just think it's always amazing. I created this caucus that I've had a lot of fun with, mostly in the Bay Area. It's called EPIC. The one here is Innovation in the Human Condition. So to look at innovation, respect it, try to nurture it, get members to understand that this innovation is something we should encourage, but there are also consequences of it around copyright laws and privacy. That at some point as policymakers we have to engage in just had a really interesting committee hearing Wednesday on autonomous cars and the collection of data for cars, and who owns that property, which was a controversial building in the legislature, what the auto industry and tech industry and third-party data collection companies are doing about that, which is a classic example of a lot of this is really wonderful innovation that helps people, but there are also consequences to that that require some robust policy discussions for our products in particular. So this is the makeup of the Congress right now, 188 Democrats. The key number is 218. We need 218 to be in the majority. Leader Pelosi is the level of energy that even has and engagement is really to see it up close, and we've seen it from a distance, it's amazing to see it up close. We were getting off the same plane about a month or so ago. We were walking out with her security detail. She always goes back a day or two earlier. And I said to her husband's name is Paul. I said, "Does Paul ever talk to you about your level of energy?" She's in her 70s and she's got all this energy. And she grabs my arm and she goes, "Oh, he thinks I'm getting worse." And I'm like, "Oh." That's all I said. The most important thing when I was in the legislature that economists told us we could do when we were dealing with your budgets and others to get the economy better was to deal with our own budget house first. In California, it's very prescriptive. There's a very constitutionally required process. Here in the Congress, it's very different. It's almost the opposite of California, where the governor has to give his budget message in January, and the fiscal year is mid-year to mid-year, as most of you know. And then we have a real distinct process, and you've got to pretty much hold of that budget once it's been accepted by the legislature and the governor. Here, the president submits a non-binding budget, and then it's sort of a political dialogue all the way through, where you agree to a budget, but it's not a hard and fast number; it's a target, and then the appropriations process is where you try to meet that budget. In California, it's sort of the opposite. You meet it, and then appropriations basically on each bill sets a guideline as to how much you will let a bill out based on how much the Department of Finance and the legislative analysts scores. So just revenues briefly, as Nick and I just talked about when your budget gets better, we rely on capital gains tax in California a lot. And that's why you have this boom and bust. There's a discussion now just from yesterday in the legislative analyst office. It says that in the coming years, the state budget should have a surplus of somewhere between $2 billion and $12 billion every year. But it's all from capital gains and this investment economy. When that slows down, this is a tech bubble or the housing bubble, then you have what we had in 2008. You were suffering because of the consequences, as were others. In the federal government, it's a combination, but it's mostly individual income taxes. And the rate we do individual income taxes, particularly for poor people or middle income people, this is the Warren Buffett rule, is his secretary should pay more as a percentage of her income or his income than he does as a billionaire. Unfortunately, the tax structure at the federal level has allowed for investment, and that's why we have the problem we have to a large degree, to be incentivized more to wages. And this just talks a little bit about, we do have some nonpartisan agreement for closing, particularly the offshoring issues where companies like Apple, they'll say they're forced to go offshore to file their federal tax returns, but there is an agreement between Speaker Ryan and Leader Pelosi that we need to take care of that in particular. It's not insignificant, but in the context of a $4 trillion federal budget, $60.6 billion is something, but it's not a ton. And this is where most of the money goes to. You hear a lot of talk about pensions and entitlement and Social Security and Medicare. The discretionary budget is mostly the Department of Defense. We had a bill earlier this year where the Navy was saying they wanted one less aircraft carrier, and we actually overruled that. I voted against it, but here's the Department of Defense saying we want less. and Congress saying, no, you're going to continue to have more, mostly because people who benefit from those jobs and the construction around it, affiliated with both the capital investment, the operations afterwards, have a hard time going back to the district and explaining that they voted to cut people's jobs. But in the national interest, we really should be cutting the Department of Defense, yes. And we talk a lot about deficits and debts, and our friends in the majority party talk a lot about this, but Bill Clinton and George Miller was an author of the balanced budget deal, which was pay as you go during the Clinton administration, where we actually had surplus. And when the Bush administration left, we had the largest deficit. And now, because of the economy, you can see the deficit is being reduced fairly dramatically. But then we do have the national debt, which is, you know, we're nothing like the Spanish, the Italians, the Greeks, but it's something I think the majority party appropriately says we should be careful about. The balance of this is, especially when you get to the Social Security Trust, no politician or very few, except for Republican candidates for president, want to cut Social Security or Medicare. Apparently they're not talking to political consultants before they go out and talk to the public. There are ways to fix this, both on the revenues, mostly on the revenue side, in my view. But you can see what a large portion of the national debt is because we're taking care of people who are paid in the Social Security system. And these are people who are generally either old or vulnerable. And personally, I think we have a commitment to them. People will get upset at town halls because we call this an entitlement. Fiscally, it's called entitlement. People will rightly say, we don't consider it an entitlement. We pay into it. It's an obligation of the country to pay into it as well. And I would agree with them on that. So this is what I like to say majority party because it less sounds less partisan. But this is what those horrible Republicans did. It's always great to get asked from attorneys on a Friday. I start telling attorney jokes as a question to this. Three attorneys walk into a bar. Stan, two of his partners. So these are important issues to sort of transition. We actually got a transportation reauthorization. I spent a lot of time in transportation in my political life. This was a consequence of Mr. Boehner announcing he was leaving and was fed up with the Freedom Caucus. And this was a good consequence of it, not that Boehner left necessarily, but the Republicans realized they really need to get something down in transportation. We have a real crisis in transportation in California in particular, but nationally, because the gas tax, which is paid for most of our infrastructure investment over the years, it hasn't been properly indexed for inflation, and at the state level, I think since 1994, the federal level in 2005 is the last time we raised it, so its purchasing power has gone down. But in addition, because our fleet's changing, and like the 10 years I have in the California Air Resources Board, we get a lot of great things around this. So the fleet, in response to carbon and California's leadership role, and the president, one of the first things he did was reinstitute CAFE standards. So our fleet is transitioning to a much more efficient fleet. We've got all these great investments around alternative renewable fuels and fuel cells that are just starting to sell in California, and with Toyota taking the battery electric cars and hybrids. So what's happened is gas prices have gone down, the gas tax has gone down, and then you've got the combination of us getting better mileage, which is all good for the environment, but we have to find a revenue source because we're billions of dollars short in infrastructure, and economists will frequently tell us next to education, infrastructure is two or three in terms of making sure the economy continues to exist and you get goods to market in a very mobile employment situation. You have to have people be able to get to work faster than they're currently able to work and make the right decisions. Education, we're on the crust, it looks like, that we might actually get that passed and get that reauthorized. The last time it was reauthorized was No Child Left Behind, which my predecessor was a co-author of with Senator Kennedy. A lot of criticism around the metrics and the key and the testing for that. So I think we're going to get that closer, right? But we're really relying on the Senate to fix it because, in my view, the bill that passed out of our committee from the majority party was not a very good bill. All the Democrats voted against it. And it's just a concern that the federal government's role when it comes to education is mostly protecting disadvantaged communities. And, you know, California will generally take care of disadvantaged communities, but other states in the South don't feel the same social responsibility. International relations, the Iran nuclear deal was a very, very big thing. It took a lot of time. And I think the Middle East is going to continue to occupy our international relations for some time to come. And the situation in Paris is an example of that. And so you can see the rest of them. As Nick said, these are the committee assignments. And I'm very happy with these two committee assignments. I'm hoping that the Oversight Committee will become less partisan. I think oversight is something coming from local government that should be nonpartisan. If I'm a liberal Democrat, I want to make sure that public services are done in the most efficient, effective way so you can help people so they won't need help. If I'm a conservative Republican, I want to give money back to taxpayers. If you do a better job of delivering services, you can do that. Unfortunately, in the Congress, it's been more directed at countries for the Democratic administration the last 6 years. Which I think is unfortunate. So, these are things that we've been able to do. It's been a struggle for me, having coming from the majority party in the legislature, where I had reached sort of a comfort or a sweet spot in the evolution of a member of the legislature. We have term limits where I had a fair degree of success in getting bills passed and helping bills get passed. And being a member of the minority, being a freshman, is definitely been an adjustment. So in the legislature, it's more about getting bills passed. In Congress, it's more about trying to get the majority party to give you amendments to legislation that they're controlling. During the reauthorization of transportation, we had 5 amendments. We tried 4. We got 3 in the floor. We got 1 passed. One of which is, I think, a really interesting and will continue to be interesting to the legal field. It has to do with faulty guardrails. And I got involved with it because I had a constituent from Richmond who died in Marin. Channel 7 did an expose on it. And it's nationally, there have been hundreds of people who lost their lives. When it was approved, and you see these all over the state, they're at exits that leave the freeway. There's basically a bumper system in there so that if you hit it, you will go off it rather than going straight into it. The company from Texas revised it. Somehow it got passed the Department of Transportation, and it was revised in such a way that whistleblowers have come forward in multiple states. Virginia's now a big state with the Attorney General is going after the company. But it led to a judgment, I believe in Texas, in a federal court for $700 million against the company because they were fraudulent. When they changed it, basically what it does, it acts more of a spear. So when this gentleman hit, he died because it didn't work as designed. So our bill basically, all it said was that the Secretary of Transportation has to develop a process so we can find out where all these are, because all of these states are carrying huge liability because we don't know where these guardrails are. So it'd be a simple fix if you put a RFD in there, which was our original suggestion, which came from one of the whistleblowers, cost about $1.50 guardrail, and then you have all this information where they are. It's sort of, the New York Times has written quite a bit about this case. Okay, so that was the one we were able to get through. Perkins loans are really important. I'm on the subcommittee with higher education. As you all know, both for a graduate degree or an undergraduate degree right now, the cost of education, we're told over and over again how important it is in an education-based, knowledge-based economy. But young people graduate from medical school or law school, debt they have to carry. Debt, student debt in the United States goes up $3 million every hour in the country. So it's something we have to get to handle. And there it is. Didn't even know that was next. So you combine that with the fact I have a 33-year-old son, a 30-year-old son. You combine that, and I forget what the term is, but it's like lost generation for our kids. They're getting into a job market that pays less, but they have higher debt service. And we're trying to encourage more people to get undergraduate degrees and graduate degrees. Of course, you know, the legal field, with some people who are waiting to see if their children pass the bar later today, that what a challenge this is in your field as well for future generations of attorneys. These are some of the things we're working on. These are some future amendments and bills. The work I've done on transportation mega projects, We found out a lot. These are projects that are over $2.5 billion. The Bay Bridge is a prime example for me. The connection for campaign contributions and how these projects get developed, I think, are important. All of these contributions are required by federal and state law to be noticed, but to connect the dots are harder to do. So my bill would say that as a request for proposals for any mega project that has federal governance, then anyone would have to submit on the request for proposal application all the campaign contributions that either the corporation or officers of the corporations have made to state, local, or federal officials who may have to vote on the project. And then we have performance standards within that, which other states and other countries do on transportation projects and things like that. On the fourth bullet, so this is a big thing when it comes to Volkswagen and the Clean Air Act. There was a carve-out as a compromise in the 70s that said you couldn't be criminally prosecuted if you violated the rules of the Clean Air Act. In Volkswagen, and this is a real thing we can talk more about the imbalance of justice right now, but it remains to be seen that Volkswagen, I think, built a business model that said if they got caught, they would have enough money to pay. But I think that if we find, certainly there should be afforded due process, that if anybody in a corporation or corporate executives knew and had willfully directed people to design these defeat the mechanisms, then they should be criminally prosecuted. Actually, on another case on ExxonMobil, myself and Ted Liu, another freshman from Southern California, we asked U.S. Attorney General to investigate ExxonMobil because the LA Times has done a story, series of stories on how they, in the 70s, were spending a lot of money on carbon. They realized it was a problem. Millions of dollars they retrofitted a super tanker because they were hoping they could prove that the oceans would sequester carbon and that wouldn't affect their petroleum sales. In the middle of that, they turned and started funding, saying there's no problem with carbon. So we think that it should have the Attorney General or state's Attorney Generals to look at, similarly to the tobacco industry, that they violated their responsibility to the public health and should be held accountable. Because of that, we were the first two to do it. All three candidates, Democratic candidates for president, have agreed to with us. And then 2 weeks ago, the New York Attorney General said that under his fairly broad discretion in New York state law, that he was going to open an investigation. So these are just some more. Right? The guardrail was a mega project through the top. Head Start was a simple one. I try to do bills or amendments. We try to target easy things that we can get done, and then we sort of have a handicapping system. Easy, mid-level, and things that people think I'm crazy for tracking, probably when we're going there, that makes me feel good. So I won't go through each one of these. The second one is a big deal. It will probably be reauthorization. You read about all that we're discovering about concussions and students' health. Unfortunately, it's been so watered down, but at least we'll start a discussion, a more robust discussion. The third one is something that I did in a similar bill in the state that didn't pass, but this is something I worked with Secretary Reich on, is that CEO compensation for years and years was 20 times median workers. It's now over 300 times. So what the law says is that you would change the corporate tax code to tax corporations higher if it is a gradation up from 100 times to above, and then that revenue would go back to make sure that student loans were never higher than the prime rate. So when you get your student loan, it would be the same that Fed charges banks, and you could always go back and renegotiate that if it was lower, just like you could have been more. So I will end there, almost out of time. These are where our offices are. You're always welcome to come to, if you're back in D.C., and visit us. I'm happy to do tours if I can, or help facilitate tours both of the Capitol and of the White House. And then the office we have here is within walking distance. It's right across the street from, I think we took some of the offices at Morris and 4th Street used to have them, I'm sure. We tried to make sure everything was out of there when we were there. This is a legal bus up. And then our other offices in Richmond, it is in Richmond City Hall. So now, just briefly, and to have you take questions. So yesterday, just as an example of my personal experience, as I continue to sort of observe and try to figure out what my role is as a freshman and taking the place of somebody who was there for 40 years and was very much part of the Democratic leadership. The Syrian vote was really interesting. So I have developed a really good friendship. I'm the only Democrat on my quarter, so I'm surrounded by Republicans. And one of my good friends, a guy named Dave Brack, who's been on the Sunday talk shows a lot, he beat Eric Cantor. He just happens to be across the hall. He's a very charming guy, a very, very conservative, a prominent member of the Freedom Caucus, who's actually in the New York Times Sunday Magazine last week, which I used to tease my communications director. You haven't succeeded until you got me on the cover of the Sunday New York Times Magazine without me being indicted or convicted. I keep going through communications directors because they think I could get on it easily if I would do what they would tell me to do. That would lead to the problem of the indictment and the conviction. So Dave was on the back of the Sunday New York Magazine, and it was an interesting article, interview. So I took it over to his office. He wasn't there, and I walk in, and the staff's immediately all these conservative people from Virginia, and they're like, oh, somebody from California is in here. Where are his horns? So I said, will you just tell Dave I'd like him to sign this? I'm proud of him. But just have him sign it to my favorite communist, Dave Brown. So he signed it. It was cute to say to my favorite member from the left coast, Dave Brown. So we were talking about it, and I said, you know, this could be a good hit piece for us in your next re-election, but we couldn't get a Democrat elected, but we could say he was in the New York Times. And he said, yeah, we're going to try to get you in the Wall Street Journal. So in sort of an introduction to Syria, I mean, so when Mr. Ryan became speaker, there was a lot of discussion about regular order. So as many of you know, whether you're at the local level, state level, or the federal level, we are governed by laws. And we're supposed to, or procedures that we're supposed to adhere to, just like you are. But then we have the discretion to move around. And at different levels, more discretion. So for the Freedom Caucus, what they kept saying was, we don't expect to get everything we want. We want to get rid of Planned Parenthood and some horrible things they want to do that we fight them on. But what they would come back to say, we want regular order. So regular order is you introduce a bill, it goes to the Rules Committee refers it to the Policy Committee, goes to the Policy Committee, if it gets out of that, or Policy Committees, if it has multiple referrals, goes to the floor, or goes to Appropriations, goes to the floor, and goes up, goes to Senate. But we keep waiving the rules under the previous leadership. So they want regular order. So Mr. Ryan came in, he went to regular order, which I would agree to. It takes more time, but you actually get to read the bills, you get more analysis, and you tend to find out what you're voting on and get more feedback. So we were doing that for a week, and then yesterday came along with Paris, and we had the Syrian bill, which then we stopped doing in regular order. It was introduced 24 hours before it hit the floor. We had a meeting with, because the president was out of the country, with his chief of staff and the Secretary of Homeland Security. It's just interesting, you know, in my view, it goes back to sort of the Willie Horton and what Lee Atwater, if you remember, Lee Atwater was first Bush's consultant who died of cancer, but before he died, he apologized for making that ad because it has, along with other things, has sort of been consistent in our political dialogue since, and then elected officials are scared to death of being Willie Horton, 30 years later. So then you get to the refugee crisis and this balance between making sure that you do appropriate things and support your security people to make sure that, to whatever degree you can, you avoid what happened in Paris, happening in Washington or San Francisco or Walnut Creek or anywhere, as opposed to, in my view, jumping to a political optic where you look like you're weak on security, but you really just want to balance what we have agreed to in our relationships with other countries in the UN, and what this country has always had part of its culture is people should be allowed to apply for refugee status and go through that. So it was really interesting. So there were 47 of the 185 Democrats who voted with the Republicans, and we sort of see it playing out. So on the merits of, or lack merits of that, the one thing, and I'll then stop for questions, is this whole gotcha mentality in politics is sort of the jump to conclusions. I saw somebody, or a liberal friend on Facebook recently said, I really like Paul Ryan. He's articulate, he's not a bad person, but you need to understand, you know, what his budget looks like. But what average American has time or has interest or inclination to learn more about that? So somewhere in our disengagement from civic engagement, paying attention to what our representatives do, and jumping to conclusions, then you have this huge military-industrial complex of political consultants who are constantly looking at being able to manipulate the political process to make people to either vote against their own interests or jump to conclusions that in the long run don't necessarily help the country. And then, I promise, this is my last thing, because it goes the other thing. And Tom Majors put this in a column recently. I like to read. I read more because I'm flying a lot. David McCullough is one of my heroes. He came to speak to a group of us at the Library of Congress, talking about his most recent book, The Wright Brothers, but he's, you know, he's in his 80s, he's articulate, he's wonderful. If you've ever seen him speak, he's a national treasure. So a member during questions said, Mr. McCullough, you know, you are an observer of American history, you've got a third of the Congress here, what would you give to us as advice? And he's got this, you know, this wobble that we all get as we get older, and he looks out and he pauses for a minute and he goes, courage. And we all look around at each other like, uh-oh. And then he says, members should have enough political courage to vote in what they know is the national interest versus what's in their interest to get reelected. And I thought that was just a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. And until we do that, I don't think we'll get out of this sort of gotcha mentality where 24 hours ago I was around friends going, how are we going to vote on this? I said, no. And he said, well, aren't you afraid to hit pieces? And I'm like, well, and it's not my bravery, because if I voted yes, I probably would have gotten more trouble in this district. But just somehow we have to get back to something closer to that, where people in representative offices aren't stupid about not getting reelected, but are less concerned about constantly getting reelected, as opposed to the effect of their contribution on the greater good. So I'll stop there. With all that, I managed to take up 10 minutes of your question and answer time, so I wanted to make sure I get as few questions from lawyers as possible.
I'll keep it political then. On the Syrian bill, was there any provisions to support the refugees in Jordan, Turkey, and Lebanon? Because for the last couple of years, only those countries have been paying for them, and Europe and the United States have done anything.
So the question was, I'll repeat questions, but then you have to deal with my editorial comments. So the question was there anything in the bill that we passed yesterday that would help with refugees where they currently are? And the answer to the question, as far as I don't know. This is one of the problems when you leave regular order. You've got a complicated bill. Not enough analysis has been done. But we had enough to know that basically what the bill did was it said that each secretary that has authority under the refugee and Homeland Security, Secretary of State, and I believe the Department of Defense, but maybe amended the AG, had to approve each one of the applicants. What the administration said was that would continue the process 2 to 7 years. It already takes 18 to 24 months. I mean, and that's from the time the refugee gets somebody to say, these are your options. So as was described to me by someone who went through it, or someone who's worked for a community or a nonprofit, if you're a refugee, you have to get to a camp that has somebody that says, here's your options of where you can go. And then if you're lucky enough, you have a nonprofit to tell you, under the UN conditions, this is how you can apply for refugee status to these countries. So that's when the clock starts, when they get the application. Well, imagine if you're, you know, a family in Syria trying to just get the hell out. You probably already spent 2 to 3 to 4 months in horrible conditions to get to the point where you have enough time to be somewhat protected and fed. So then the clock starts. So what the administration, nobody could tell us that this bill is actually going to lead to security. So one of my arguments was, what's the hurry? You know, we're going to make sure you can do the time out, but they're already under heightened security. And as far as we know, there may have been one of the eight people involved in, so far involved in Paris, who may have come through refugees. So you certainly have to be careful of it. But most of those folks were people who were citizens and had become terrorists while they were there. So it's not so much the policy discussion, it's how we vote about it. It's that it's all driven towards, we're gonna put as many Democrats in tough districts to make a tough vote with the optics of we can send hit pieces and say, you let a Syrian terrorist make you blow your kids up. And you know, we do it too. So I'm not just saying Republicans do it, but we have to get out of that because there is a legitimate policy discussion that should take longer, that should be a discussion with the country, as opposed to, get you on this one and then just roll it off to the floor. Over here.
Might there ever be a time where Congress starts complying with the laws that they pass to themselves that they require everybody else?
Yeah, so the question is, will there ever be a time when the laws passed by Congress apply to themselves? I hear this a lot, that we don't contribute to Social Security. There was a time before 1994 that was the case. It's not the case since 1994. Newt Gingrich and Congressman Miller actually helped negotiate that. I was with a group of former members of the California legislature. We'd go out for dinner with Karen Bass, former speaker, first African-American leader of a legislative body in the history, woman African-American to lead a legislative body in the history of this country when I was in the assembly, dear friend. We were talking about our jobs, and we have paid $174,000 a year, hasn't been raised in a while. And then the retirement, if I stay for 10 years, I get about $2,000 a month. You stay for 20 years, you know, you stay, so there was a time, and Karen said, laughingly, she goes, until I went down and asked for retirement people, I just assumed what I read in the paper and what the Tea Party people were saying. And as soon as I got elected, I got paid $180,000 a year for the rest of my life. And it turns out not to be true. The other thing is, Obamacare, the Affordable Care Act, why didn't you make that apply to members of Congress? Actually, it does. So, again, this is some of the optics that you have to...
You think of things like labor laws and
cyber
laws?
Oh, that's a good one. Yeah, I chaired the Labor Committee for a while in the Senate, and I was amazed that some of the members who we would have be told that they weren't treating their employees the way they wanted people to treat their employees in the outside world. That the laws do apply, but just as you all know, you can have laws in the application of the administration of those laws differently. I think these jobs are wonderful jobs, and I've loved doing them, but they're, for instance, in the legislature, when we pass term limits, you're prohibited from having retirement or health care or any benefits. So you take, like, one of my best friends in the legislature, now a city attorney in Los Angeles, Mike Fuhrer, he's got an undergraduate degree from Harvard, a law degree from Harvard, very bright guy. He took 6 years out of his life to be in the California State Assembly because, you know, you get no benefits from that. So generally, I don't think we're, at least in my experience, I might be missing something, but you can look at how much I'm worth, and people are always shocked to find out I'm not worth very much. I had a colleague, Paul Cook, who came across the aisle and said, I was actually rich. I said, I own restaurants. I was rich for a while, and then I wasn't rich for a while, and then I wasn't rich for a while. So that's a long way of saying I think we should apply the laws to everybody evenly, including ourselves. And generally, I think they are, but there are people who try to do it differently.
Yes. How do you think the next election will affect the makeup of the House?
So Ms. Pelosi actually thinks that we have a shot of taking control. That's her job. Most people will find that it would be very difficult for Democrats because of the gerrymandering issue for us to get control. So we have a short-term strategy to try to get control. And then we have a longer-term strategy that does what the Republicans did during the last census and redistricting, try to make sure. And our strategy is not necessarily take control of state houses, although that's part of it. The other strategy is just to get independent commissions. Because if we think if we get independent commissions based on the demographics and the way the voting, and if we can get people registered to vote, young people and people who reflect the nation and the diversity of the nation, that will do better, much better. So I have guarded optimism. When you look at polling generically nationwide, people hold the Republican majority responsible for much, and President Bush responsible for what's happened to the economy and the middle class. But when they go to vote, it's not necessarily the case. And in some weird ways, it's working, except for the gerrymandering, because a lot of people who are in the Freedom Caucus, I had one of them, who I won't say his name, but we were walking back, that he had voted for the Ex-Im Bank, which I can't imagine why that would be that controversial. And he was lamenting, and this is a very, very Tea Party conservative member. And, you know, we were having a nice discussion, and he said, oh, somebody's going to run against me. I'm going to get run by somebody from the right. And I'm like, how is that possible? you're like, to me, you're crazy. And there's conservative, and there's yeah, the same thing with liberals. There's liberal, and there's crazy liberal. There's conservative, and crazy conservative. And the poor guy, he walked back to his office, and he had a successful career before. But he was just like trembling. I said, well, you know, if you lose, you go back to your old job. And he was like, oh, my God. So that's a long way of saying that I think it's a long shot for Democrats. But we have to get the redistricting done, right? There's somebody over here.
So. Yeah, what can the Congress do to fix the bridges in our country and raise the transfer and raise the gas tax? I mean, it seems like it's crazy that we don't do it.
Well, the first thing we could do is index the gas tax for inflation. It's sort of like minimum wage. I mean, my friends in the restaurant business, including people at Walnut Creek, get mad at me because I support raising the minimum wage. But, you know, when I was in the restaurant business, my lease in the restaurants had a CPI, and I knew that, you know, that if I couldn't pass it on to my customers, I had a problem with controlling costs. So when you look at purchasing power for people, you have to do that same thing with the gas tax. You can't say it's this in 1994 and never raise it for inflation and expect you to get the same investment in the maintenance and operations and capital of your transportation system. And then what's made our transportation system more difficult in a place like the Bay Area in particular is that up until 10 or 15 years ago, the social model for transportation models were generally one income and one household going to the same career, same job. So from here, it was how do you get in the financial district? And then it came, ooh, how do you get to Bishop Ranch and Hacienda? And then, as a complete surprise to all of us, was how do you get people from Tracy and Brentwood to Mountain View? So all of those things are our responsibilities to adapt to in the public sector and to change, but we have been very slow to do that, and that resulted in the Bay Area. This is where I can really get my soapbox. We've got this amazing economy, but one of the two biggest threats to our economy in the Bay Area is housing costs and transportation. And we still keep sort of going through the motion about both of them, and we have to find a sustainable funding source for transportation. I had a bill of legislature which resulted in, you know, they have these risk assessments for our safety people. I got two legitimate death threats for proposing that we study a vehicle miles travel tax, which other countries and other states have looked at. So the two death threats weren't as threatening as Fox News kept calling me and asking me. So we have to, and that's another political thing, is nobody wants to go to the public and say, if you want your infrastructure built, if you want us to start reducing the time it takes you to get from where you live to where you work, then we're going to have to talk about how we pay for that. And on top of that, we have to be more performance driven in how we do that, so people have more confidence in how we do it. Yes, sir.
I'm from Worcester, grew up there, so.
Worcester, Massachusetts.
Wicked Pissa.
Yeah, Wicked Pissa, yeah. We used to say when I spent my 4 years at Holy Crossroads, what's it like outside? And they'd say it's Worcester, and I'm and it was horrible.
Realistically, is there any, do you see anyone in Congress or anyone proposing a way to address the, what you were lamenting about the lack of real national focus of how you approach, how congresspeople approach issues in this whole issue of special interests? Is there really, can we ever expect the human race in our Congress to deal with that in any effective way?
You know, in Bob Reich's good book, he talks about how he spends the first two-thirds of the book basically driving you to hopelessness. Country's broken and never fixes. And then he starts, what do we do about it, by saying America as a democratic, secular, capitalistic system has had this remarkable ability, right when you think it's going in a direction or trajectory that is, you can't save it without some kind of insurrection, that we start to find ways to fix it. I think there should be more sense of urgency, because the combination of money and power has always been part of our process, but it's particularly a problem right now. For some of the reasons I raised, I would say that sometimes it's everywhere in this country. With, you know, there are things that we did in this country that, from a historical perspective, just an abomination. But if we don't deal with this wage capital, if we don't have a vibrant middle class in the United States with the opportunity to move up into it, and if you make the economic argument that you have to have people have enough discretionary income to buy consumer goods. And so I'm hoping, but the connection with that is campaign contributions. You know, he makes a point of talking about how many states, 30 states, including California, judges are elected as opposed to appointed. It was a comment in his book about Europeans saying that's the craziest thing we ever heard of. You can't distribute justice equally. Now, fortunately, we haven't had special interests as involved in the judicial races historically. But his argument is that you're seeing more and more of it. I mean, you see it in Florida right now. They're trying to get rid of, or they tried to get rid of the three Supreme Court justices who ruled for the redistricting was unconstitutional. And there's still an attempt to get rid of them. So they tried to recall them. They failed. And now they're trying to do something else. We have time for one more?
Yeah, one quick one.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
It seems like there's almost two electorates in this country. The electorate that turns out for a presidential election and the one that turned out for off your election. Do you see anything that could be done beyond exhortation of to increase the amount of turnout, the level of turnout in off your elections?
Well,
I think that's a lot of support for the Tea Party and sort of more active minority groups.
So one big thing that we just did here in California this past legislative session, Secretary Padilla, who's over the Senate, was a sponsor of Secretary of State of the U.S. Motor Voter Registration. So when you go to the DMV, you get your license to register to vote. We may have to make it clear to people that when they get there, that they can access their absentee ballot. I had a bill in the legislature with my current roommate, when we were both in the Assembly, Jared Huffman from Marin, an attorney, that would just make vote by mail in enough. You know, there's still provisions on the days, the places you can deliver it. They do that in Oregon. The results, and not only the research says more people voting, but they also understand the issues better because they spend the time to read it before they vote. So there are a lot of things like that we can do. But ultimately, the research also shows that most poor and middle class people more and more feel like the system's rigged against them. So why not? So we have to change both of those. And there's some technical things you can do, but I think there's some larger, you know, you haven't endorsed in the presidential race yet, but you need people like Bernie pointing this out, I think. So I will end there. Thank you all for inviting me.